Good morning and a very warm welcome to our service this morning on this Remembrance Sunday. We've already begun our reflections on the theme of remembrance as we saw the devastating effect that wars have had, not only on people but also on the natural world. As we come together today to reflect on the traumas of war and conflict, we also come to pledge ourselves to be people of peace. As we do that, we're going to have our act of remembrance now. During this, you'll see one or two familiar faces, and I've also asked a friend of mine, John, to play the bugle for us. And so we begin our act of remembrance with these words from Psalm 121. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From whence will my help come? My help comes from the Lord, who made heavens and earth. And these words from Lamentations. This I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. We meet in the presence of God. We commit ourselves to work in penitence and faith for reconciliation between the nations, that all people may together live in freedom, justice, and peace. We pray for all who in bereavement, disability, and pain continue to suffer the consequences of fighting and terror. We remember with thanksgiving and sorrow those whose lives, in world wars and conflicts past and present, have been given and taken away. And so we hear the well-known words which lead us into our 2-minute silence.
They shall not grow old as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them.
At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them.
Thank you.
Ever living God, we remember those whom you have gathered from the storm of war into the peace of your presence. May that same peace calm our fears, bring justice to all peoples, and establish harmony among the nations, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We now make together an act of commitment. I will ask three questions, and the answer to each, I hope, is we will. Let us commit ourselves to responsible living and faithful service. Will you strive for all that makes for peace? We will. Will you seek to heal the wounds of war? We will. Will you work for a just future for all humanity? We will. Merciful God, we offer to you the fears in us that have not yet been cast out by love. May we accept the hope you have placed in the hearts of all people and live lives of justice, courage, and mercy through Jesus Christ, our risen Redeemer. Amen. Our hope is alone in Christ, on whom we rest. And so we are going to listen to a song that says just that. Use this time to reflect and to pray. I dare not trust.
the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. When the mountains are falling, when the waters are rising, I shall be safe.
The reading is taken from the book of Amos, chapter 5, verses 18 to 24. Woe to you who desire the day of the Lord! Why would you have the day of the Lord? It is darkness and not light, as if a man fled from a lion and a bear met him, or went into the house and leaned with his hand against the wall, and a serpent bit him. Is not the day of the Lord darkness and not light, and gloom with no brightness in it? I despise your feasts, and I take no delight in your solemn assemblies. Even though you offer me your burnt offerings and cereal offerings, I will not accept them. And the peace offerings of your fatted beasts I will not look upon. Take away from me the noise of your songs. To the melody of your harps I will not listen. But let justice roll down like waters, and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
These words from Amos are not easy words. They're not the poetic comfort of the middle part of Isaiah that we read a few weeks ago. They're not the whispered promises of redemption and restoration. These are harsh words, hard words, hurtful words, perhaps. They are words of wrath and pain and lament. These words are not easy to hear, and nor are they easy to preach on, but they are important words. They were important for Amos to communicate to the people of Israel, and they have the ability to communicate important things to us now. They tell us about God's nature, God's character, and God's heart. Amos was not a career prophet. He had no vision from God calling him to prophecy or an angelic visitation. He was a shepherd from Tekoa in Judah, writing in about 755 BC. He was an intercessor, a prophet who was driven by a burning sense of moral righteousness and social justice. A prophet who stood in the dark places, the gap between God and Israel, his chosen people, and cried out. The whole book is stern, austere, and uncompromising, a combination of oracles and visions expressing the pain and scorn of God. A lament penned and shared at a time of economic prosperity, but a time when moral values had declined and there was a widespread oppression of those on the edges, those in the shadows. In the first half of these verses, Amos refers to Israel waiting for the day of the Lord, a day which was coming when God would do great things for Israel, when there would be final victory, perhaps. The way Amos writes makes it sound like Israel were wearing their status as the chosen people of God like a badge of honour, believing that they had the monopoly on God's grace and goodness. Israel was looking forward to this coming day, almost with glee, so that they could sit back and watch whilst the Lord Almighty destroyed all who stood against him. Amos warns them that it is their behaviour, their choices, their oppression of others, their complicity in the corruption and moral decay of society that will be defeated. Amos warns Israel that they cannot take God for granted. Israel was not protected from the wrath of God because, as the chosen people, they were not set aside to be untouchable, but set aside to be a holy nation, one that declared daily, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength." Israel's actions in Amos's time were not ones that loved the Lord their God. They were the actions of a people who had forgotten what God had done for them. They'd forgotten who they were in him. In the second half of these verses, Amos speaks with the voice of God, condemning and rejecting the worship of Israel. Not because it was corrupt or offered to the wrong God, it wasn't misplaced, but because their worship was empty. God rejects Israel's worship here because it has become divorced from justice and righteousness. Justice and righteousness, characteristics and gifts of God. Justice and righteousness go hand in hand. Justice is a familiar word. Perhaps it's a word that slips too easily off our tongues without us realising its weightiness, without us acknowledging that we all have a part to play in its fruition. Justice is a multi-layered concept. Justice in the kingdom of God is fairness and equality. It is attending to the needs of others, breaking the unjust systems that enslave and oppress. It is recognising our privilege and naming it, educating ourselves, admitting when we are wrong, admitting that when we are part of the problem. Justice is seeking out those in the shadows. It is standing with those on the sidelines. It is embracing the excluded, including the othered and welcoming the stranger. Righteousness is about relationship. Being righteous in God's eyes is not about doing good deeds, about ticking all the boxes or winning holy points. Righteousness is about being in right relationship with our God, who is creator and redeemer and sustainer of all things. Righteousness is relating to God, positioning ourselves in a relationship with God that recognises that God is God and we are not. Whilst also recognising that humanity, as all God's children, have a commonality. They have access to him, they have a sameness, and all can have the same relationship with God, no matter who they are, where they come from, or what they do. Justice and righteousness are not requirements from God, but they are gifts that flow from him. Both are characteristics of God, both are also actions of his people to those around them. And the people of God have a choice. To support the causes of justice and righteousness, to help justice and righteousness flourish, to sustain their presence, fight for their success, or they can choose to stand in the way, stay silent, obstruct justice. Israel had done the latter. And verse 24 is God's roar of outrage. But let justice roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. These words are words of anger, not a call to good deeds. These words have an urgency, a demanding tone. An immediate and sudden deluge is needed, one that will see Israel repent and restore worship that is pleasing to God, rather than ritualistic. Justice and righteousness need to roll down so that the actions and worship of God's people can be brought back together, so that one flows from the other. Justice and righteousness need to be able to flow freely so that the heart of worship and the heart of God are reunited. So what would God say about our worship now? In a time when all of our rituals are on hold again. In a season when we have been without them and then returned to an unfamiliar form of worship. Perhaps we have now stripped back our worship, coming before God with next to nothing. In a season that is unfamiliar to all of us, in this season, God still sees us. He still watches over us. He still receives our worship and our lament with joy and with love. But our worship cannot be inward looking even now. It cannot be separated from the one we worship. Our worship still needs to lift our eyes, to fix them on God, on who God is, on what God is like. Our worship still needs to ask, what does God want of me now? How does God want me to live? What should be flowing from my worship in this season? Where are justice and righteousness rolling down? But why? Why are justice and righteousness important now? The world has been shaken, plunged into an unknown way of life, disrupted rather than interrupted, by which I mean we cannot simply go back to what was before, release the pause button and continue. Too much has changed. The COVID pandemic has stripped away the shiny exteriors of life, exposed the hurt, the anger, the disunity and the mistrust. It has shone light on the oppression, the desolation, the sidelined, the mistreated and the marginalised. The murder of George Floyd in America was a tipping point which saw the rising up of Black Lives Matter, a groundswell of recognition that racism not only exists but it is prevalent, divisive and dangerous. That people are still othered and excluded because of their skin colour, their cultural background, their differences. It created a wake-up call to the church, to us, to me, a call to accept my part in the pain, my silence as complicity, my privilege and my power. An alarm call that we need to talk about race and how the lack of conversation affects our worship, our action and our prayers. This is the justice and righteousness that needs to roll down and flow through us. The lockdown exposed those most in need in our community. Through the meals and the food box projects, we were able to meet some of that need, but social action is only half of the story. Yes, we are called to help. Yes, we are called to serve. But Amos's warning is that unless actions are married to justice, which continually flows and waters and sustains, then it's falling short. Yes, we should definitely carry on supporting the food bank, but we should also be asking questions to those in power about why there still needs to be food banks. Questions about what is being done to end hunger and poverty, which is prevalent in every town and city, every church congregation. We should not celebrate the opening of a food bank, but lament the need for more. This is justice and righteousness. And whilst all of us have a part to play, Amos's lament is to the whole of Israel. It is to the whole church today. It is a heartfelt cry to wake up, to lift our eyes up, to let justice and righteousness flow from us and through us and beyond us. It is a call to carry on bringing our worship to God, a cry reflected in the words of Romans 12. A cry to take your everyday, ordinary life, your sleeping, eating, going to work and walking around life and place it before God as an offering. And as we offer our lives as worship, our comings and our goings, our thoughts, our choices, our actions, when we see our similarities, our commonality and our humanity in all its difference and diversity, then we will be righteous. Then righteousness will be like an ever-flowing stream. When we take the light of Christ in us, the power of God working through us, the Spirit of God within us, and share it with the lonely and the lost, the sidelined and those in the shadows, the marginalised and the oppressed, then justice will roll down like waters, feeding and flooding and watering the world. Amen.
Judgment burns, how we have fallen. Oh Lord, you stand appalled to see your laws of love so scorned and life so broken. Have mercy, Lord. Cross your town, triumphant in this land.
Let us pray. Father, we pray for our church and our leaders as gathered worship is once again not possible. We ask that you would sustain us as we keep in touch with each other from our homes. We pray especially for all those who are lonely and vulnerable at this time. Lead us to those who need our help. We pray for Kevin and Hannah as they continue to lead us through these difficult times with changes to what we can and can't do as a church and thinking ahead in the midst of such uncertainty. We pray especially for those who will suffer most from this new lockdown and pray for all those who will support them. Those working to support families and individuals, our NHS workers and school staff. We pray for those who are worried about where their next meal will come from or just how they will survive a long dark winter without the contact that usually sustains them. On this Remembrance Sunday, we remember all those who have given their lives in the defence of the freedoms that we are blessed by you to enjoy. When we think of the hundreds of thousands of poppies that will not have been bought this year, may we consider how we support those that need our help today. We pray for our world and the great challenges facing our world leaders, the political divisions which cause hardships for the vulnerable and downtrodden, the resurgent pandemic which seems to affect the most vulnerable the worst, the economic crisis which will undoubtedly hurt the poorest most, and the impact of the climate catastrophe that will undoubtedly hurt the poorest most. Lord, we pray the same prayer that Amos prayed. Let justice roll on like a river, righteousness like a never-failing stream. Heavenly Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
The Collect for today. God, our refuge and strength, bring near the day when wars shall cease and poverty and pain shall end, that earth may know the peace of heaven through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Trusting in the compassion of God, together we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Welcome to Community News. First thing to say is about our services. Obviously, you'll be aware that we are not allowed to meet for our Sunday worship or gathered worship at all for the next month. So we intend to be back here on the 6th of December. In the meantime, we have our service like this one at 9:30 on a Sunday on YouTube, followed by coffee after church on Zoom. If you want the link for that, then please do speak to me. I'll be glad to give that to you. We also have families at 4 meeting on Zoom and youth Zoom also happening. These are every 2 weeks. If you're interested in joining in either of those, then please do speak to myself or to Hannah. We won't be meeting during the week for morning prayer on a Tuesday or Thursday, but the church will be open on Tuesdays in the morning from 9:30 till 11. If you want to drop in for private prayer, then please feel free to do so. Wednesday communion will instead be held on Zoom as our Wednesday Comzoomian, which is morning prayer. If you want the link for that, again, please speak to me. You're very welcome to join us for that half an hour's morning prayer and a bit of chat and conversation on a Wednesday. We're also started a new session of prayer on Friday mornings, also on Zoom. This is a time of listening prayer where we take some time out to be quiet, to listen to what God might say to us as he speaks to us through words and scriptures. If you want to join in with that, please contact me for the Zoom link. There are also other things going on, also on Zoom. Wednesday Club is meeting every week. We have several home groups meeting weekly or fortnightly. So if you want to be tapped into any of those communities, do please speak to me. This is a difficult time for many, and we want to keep you in touch with other people as much as we can. So that's what's happening regarding our church services. Last week we let you know about the Auction of Promises. If you do have any ideas, suggestions for Auction of Promise things for the Christmas Fair charity appeal, then please do speak to Anthony and Miranda, who would be happy to add you to the list. It could be anything from auctioning a skill that you have, any items that you've made, handicrafts and that kind of thing. It could be acceptable items, things, social things, you know, like a one-to-one guided walk, or later on we're allowed to meet in bigger groups, going for a walk together, or the usual meals and those kind of things when that becomes possible. So whatever it is that you think people will pay money to join in with, to raise money for charity, please do speak to them. If you have other ideas that aren't Auction of Promises, then please speak to Chris Nutting. By the way, speaking of Chris does such a lot of work behind the scenes with our budgets and finances. It's a really difficult time at the moment to be doing that. There's lots of extra worries and concerns. So thank you, Chris, for all that you do for us. Birthdays coming up this week. Lockdown may happen, but birthdays don't stop. So a very happy birthday this week to Tony and to Danny. So we're going to draw our time of worship together to a close. We're going to say the prayer of blessing and then have our final song, God of Justice. Maybe see you soon for coffee after church on Zoom.
May God, who gives patience and encouragement, give you a spirit of unity to live in harmony as you follow Jesus Christ, so that with one voice, you may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. We go into the world to walk in God's light, to rejoice in God's love and to reflect God's glory. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.
To rescue the weak and the poor, chose to serve and not be served. Jesus, you have called us. Freely we've received now, freely we will give. We must go live to feed the hungry, stand beside the broken. We must go stepping forward. Keep us from just singing, move us into action. To act justly every day, loving mercy in every way, walking humbly before you, God. You have shown us what you require. Freely we've received now, freely we will give. We must go live to feed the hungry, stand beside the broken. We must go stepping forward. Keep us from just singing, move us into action. We must go. Send us out, fill us up and send us out. Fill us up, send us out, Lord. Fill us up and send us out. Fill us up and send us out. Fill us up and send us out, Lord. Fill us up, send us out.
Lost the button. It's keys. Oh. It's in the other hand.